So William Stafford was a great poet, and I don't think he got the acclaim in his lifetime that he deserves. He's the man that taught at Lewis and Clark and wrote a poem a day, and left his wife thousands and thousands and thousands of poems when he died. And I think, but he also published some 35 books of poetry in his lifetime. And his students asked, how can you write a poem a day? And he says, well, lower your standards. but the man was a great poet and I think a very decent human being. He was a conscientious objector, and he was put in a camp for 4 years during the war. And he and a group of like-minded people would get up at 3 a.m. and before they had to go to work, and they would talk philosophy and talk about how they wanted their lives to unfold and how they wanted the country to unfold and those kinds of things. And then when the war ended, he was released, and I think he finished graduate school and then went to Lewis and Clark and taught there the rest of his career. But here's a poem of his. It's entitled, A Ritual to Read to Each Other. If you don't know the kind of person I am, and I don't know the kind of person you are, a pattern that others made may prevail in the world, and following the wrong God home, we may miss our star. For there is many a small betrayal in the mind, a shrug that lets the fragile sequence break, sending with shouts the horrible errors of childhood storming out to play through the broken dike. As elephants parade holding each elephant's tail, but if one wanders, the circus won't find the park. I call it cruel, and maybe the root of all cruelty, to know what occurs, but not recognize the fact. And so I appeal to a voice, to something shadowy, a remote, important region in all who talk. Though we could fool each other, we should consider, lest the parade of our mutual life get lost in the dark. For it is important that awake people be awake, or a breaking line may discourage them back to sleep. The signals we give, yes or no or maybe, should be clear. The darkness around us is deep. Nothing I've ever written in a flyer or on my website means anything or is at all representative of what I bring to the party. I admire that you came out anyway after reading the flyer.
Is that deliberate on your part?
No, my talents lie elsewhere. And had it not been for word of mouth, I wouldn't be standing here tonight. I'd be working at Costco or something, but thank you for coming out. So, I don't think you'd be in the room tonight, nor do I think you'd be interested in what is going to happen here tomorrow, unless at some point in your life you had some kind of an experience, either in your awareness or outside your awareness, where you bumped up against the mystery, or had an encounter with the divine, with allness, or some aspect of the mystery that you can resonate with, but it's entirely non-ordinary. In other words, something prompted something in you to get roused, to move toward becoming curious or awakening. In my thinking, the mystery, which is my word for what the New Agers call the universe, or the totality of all things, about which we understand essentially nothing, and anything we think we understand is predicated on some epistemology, but we made that up too. We absolutely know nothing. We make things up and act as though they are true, and we live out our lives. But in my thinking, there is something in the mystery that repeatedly and in an ongoing way is constantly attempting to get our attention, constantly attempting to invite us to become more than our upbringing, more than our culture, more than whoever we think we are, to create a culture of the self. And people who have had that kind of awakening, it didn't come from your personality. We're not in charge of whether we will have an awakened life or not. The mystery will get our attention and we'll allow it a receptivity, and then we'll either act in accord or follow its movement for us, and continue that and remain in a process of awakening, or we'll go back to sleep, or we never hear the call, we're never roused from our personality level engagement with life. But to me, that constantly, all of us, in every moment, there's a motion to rouse us from the smallness of humanity, the smallness of our thought, the smallness of our imagination. And if you've been awakened or had a glimpse of something beyond the intellect, beyond the imagination, often there are three different paths or types of activities we involve ourselves with. And one is being in service. It's giving to others. Now, to me, every being or force that there is that differentiates and presents as a being has a personal part, and all of us want to help. But if we've been roused, there is a part of us that wants to be in service to something bigger. And that's one category. There's another response that people have to awakening or the beginnings of awakening, and that has to do with some kind of fulfillment that is, in a sense, separate from service. And it might be with art, with creativity, with our sensuality, basking in the sun, enjoying swimming in the tropics, where there's just a life of invoking our sentience and enjoying beautiful gardens with a myriad colors and the fragrances that move us. Because we relate that somehow to something bigger, and that it is life is a gift, and involve ourselves in that. And the third way that some people respond to being touched by the mystery is a repeated desire to directly experience the non-ordinary and the mystery. And these can be people engaged in LSD or ayahuasca, or it can also be people involved in gardening or cooking, where there's just this transcendent experience, or involved in poetry or music, where we're carried away. The issue is that I think quite often we get stuck in one of those domains, and a lot of us don't involve ourselves in all three. And this is why the people who are involved in giving service to another person or to people, and if I don't take care of myself, invoke those other three kinds of paths, we burn out. We don't feed ourselves. Think of all the people you know who are in service to other beings. Nearly always do so at the expense of themselves. the majority of them. And there's an interesting question that I don't think it's a question, but I'll pose it as one. If I'm giving to others, but not giving equivalently to myself, is there really a net gain in the universe, in the mystery? And it's something that I think warrants our attention. Or I have a friend who, were his wife not such a competent businesswoman, they'd probably be homeless, because this guy spends all his time on the ski slopes or on the water skiing, or I don't think he's ever worked more than 5 minutes in his life, because he's constantly involved in the fulfillment, the seeking the pleasure with the beauty of life. And he jumps out of helicopters and skis down mountains and does a lot of cool stuff. But he's stuck in that. And that is as handicapping as stuck in a service role. And then there's the same, similarly for people who constantly are meditating, or constantly in prayer, or constantly involving themselves with ayahuasca or something like that. And this is a sobering thing to have these kinds, to develop these kinds of understandings, and realizing, oh, I'm the guy that spent the last 35 years in this service slot, totally ignoring the other parts of my life. It's a very sobering reality. And to look back and look at all the costs in every domain of my life by having spent my life the way I have. And the analogy, I think, would be, a friend of mine mentioned it. I was thinking of another one, but I'll use his. He said, imagine striking one note on a piano your entire life. There is nothing creative about that. Or making the same meal every time you ate and eating the exact same food. There's nothing creative about that. And that's a bit sobering. See, there are three types of injuries that I think we suffer. And one is the shock, both a biological and energetic shock, of a one-time trauma. The next type of injury that we suffer are multiple or ongoing traumas. But the third form of injury that I think is pandemic, and that's the unhonored self. When we fail to recognize that we ourselves are complex and contradictory people or beings, and that the creativity of a life demands that we honor everything about us and engage all aspects of ourself. That the personality has to do what it has to do. And if it needs to spend time in warm water, find a way to spend time in warm water. If it needs to draw, draw. If it needs to paint, paint. If it needs to write, write. If it needs to sing, no matter what else is going on. And I think the way that our societies are set up, that there are periods of our life where we're giving maybe everything we can to one part of ourself that part expresses. And then we wait till another part of our life to express the other thing, or it never gets expressed, or we wait till another part of our life to express something else. I think 8 years ago was the first time I wrote a poem, and I've written several, and I've written a lot, and most of them are horrible, but there are two or three out of the lot that are pretty good. But I had no idea, even though I've loved poetry, I had no idea that, oh, I could write poetry. Now, if you read it, you think, no, he can't write poetry, but The point is it doesn't matter whether it's good. The point is that that part gets expression. So what gets in the way of the expression? The injuries, the one-time trauma, the multiple traumas, or part of the unhonored self is not being seen or met by a parent. Maybe one of your parents saw who you were, maybe the other didn't, maybe neither saw who you are. And the consequences of that, and we could drill down in that, but I don't think it's necessary. But the thing about these issues in our lives are impediments to the expression that is possible for us here, the expression and experience. And doing everything that we ourselves inside are drawn to do, and actually love to do. And so the question is, what do you love doing? And for a lot of us, that's a difficult question to answer, because we move away from this awareness of what I love doing, and we do the things that we think are possible to do. But then all the other things that we really love to do that we don't think are possible, we don't. And so back up a minute about the injuries. In this body of work called Constellations, that there's an event happened somewhere in the ancestry. In a sense, there are, we as people and the ancestors too, we can do things that make an impact in this local space-time only. Like I could take off my shoe or kick my shoe at you and my shoe would hit you in the leg. And that there's no impact through the generations. But there are other things that I can do that would create a ripple through my lineage. And yours. And when the it would be a shock. It'd be an energetic or biological shock is created, and they both. There's a shock in energy and a shock physiologically. And those things would ripple through the past and through the future. And it's like installing an app on your phone. The first time there's a trauma or an incident that creates a non-local, an event that goes beyond the local moment, there's an app installed. But then the next time that person or their daughter or their granddaughter or their great-granddaughter, and she experiences some kind of a shock, it activates that app that was installed several generations before, and then there's an expression in some, either a disease or illness or some problem. The younger one is living out a life that he or she would not have asked for. And so those are the kinds of issues that get in the way of us fully expressing our lives. There are events and circumstances. See, it's when we experience a shock that is wholly and totally unexpected. It is a psychological shock, but it's also simultaneously a biological shock, because our system responds to it. It happens all the time. When I worked in Cyprus, the first 5 years I would go there, no matter what issue somebody presented, we had to work with the war of 1974. What was the impact when the bombs were dropped and the shells were being fired? What was the impact on the family in the house? Or what was the impact on the family because there was a brother who was in the army? We don't think in this way, these terms, but there are events that imprint in the system and roll through generations. Is that at all helpful?
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah.
So the woman had to wear a black dress at the wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And how did that affect the paraplegic?
The the specifics had to do with, I'll talk process, not those people, had to do with there are wrongs that we can perpetrate that will later be atoned for in the lives of grandchildren or many generations down.
So energetically, it goes from the black dress and she gives it to her children.
And it iterates through the generations in one form or another. But in her case, she was, it seemed like the final atonement. There are consequences for everything that's done, and some of the consequences are pleasant, some are unpleasant. And sometimes, it's often easy to see in business, in family businesses, where there's been a lot of exploitation, either of resources or of people, that one or two generations down, there are a lot of injuries or disabilities in or deaths of children. There's a case where a family business they were canning food, and they had heavy metals in the food, and they injured a couple hundred thousand people before they stopped the food, and the two generations down, every child had a severe physical disability that we could trace right to there. I don't see past lives that work the way we think they work. There are, I think, soul generations. And what I see when I look at somebody, when I see it, they're just lines of energy that move through the life of someone else. And that's what we call a past life, because we have awarenesses that go both ways. As far as, in her case, the Hellinger's term was entanglement. And Hellinger said we carry the burden for those who came before out of love. And maybe that's fair to say. I sort of look at it as though there was a healing that needed to happen in the ancestry, but the consciousness wasn't sufficient. So here we are multiple generations later, and this woman with this issue creates a healing. When she creates the healing for herself, it goes back through the generations. And I've also seen it go. I've had people in the room representing 25 generations in the future, and you can just see it go right through. But I don't call it a past life thing like that. I don't see it that way. Yeah, you have to be careful. Don't believe anything I say. And I was teasing you a little bit there, but what it requires is for you to have some kind of a story or a model in your system that allows for that kind of thing to be possible. Otherwise, it makes no sense what I'm talking about. I've specifically stayed away from reading physics or something for quite a long time. There are a lot of people approach this with the science, but there's a lot of there was a, what I when I was reading there was a lot of conversation around we can experience an event now, and the cause is actually in the future, and there's some was it Laszlo who's been publishing some books recently on. I'm forgetting this guy's name. But he's my friends who've been reading it say these guys are explaining how constellations work, and they tell me how we can work in these non-ordinary fields of reality. And I say, no, they're not explaining it, because it doesn't work the way that they're saying it works. I'm wholly inadequate to come up with something, even a metaphor, right now to help you. And usually I can come up with something that is helpful. Right now I'm not. But I don't think that's the punchline of our conversation here. That story was just an example, but it's not the point. And the point is that there are events in our lives that inhibit us from the kind of experience and expression that we want. and there are antecedents to it. There are events in our past, in the past of our families, that are responsible for us in part not having the lives that we want. And the events and the difficulties that we have in our life is actually the prompt, the tool to get us to do some work that will clear the issues for ourselves, and when they do, it clears those for those who came before us. And unless you have a model that, or the capacity to see into non-ordinary realities, then knowing about that doesn't matter. But what matters is, oh, my life is more full and rich right now, and I'm having more of the expression I want. My father died in middle of the December, and he carried around the depression right here in front of him, right? He was 95 when he died. But his whole life, he had the depression right here. And it stood between him and everything that he did. And when he died, there was a staggeringly profound non-physical weight that lifted from me. And that's related to to his issue. And am I free of it yet? No, but a hell of a lot more than I was. Yeah. Yeah. Other comment or question? Has anything I said tonight been at all coherent, or are we here, or are we kind of disparate? We're here? Okay. So just briefly, a little bit about Hellinger's model. Hellinger had been a priest in South Africa for 17 years or so, running a large school system, mostly working with the Zulu. And he was presented with a question: do you care more about Catholicism, or do you care about humanity? And when he answered that question, he left the priesthood and was then trained as a psychotherapist. And when he began his practice, he realized that none of the modalities he'd been trained with fitted his clients, or so he believed. So through the years, he developed new models of how to work with his clients, and constellations came out of that. And his model essentially was that there's a greater soul, oversoul, and then there's the soul of the family, and then there's a personal soul. And the soul of the family is what Rupert Sheldrake refers to as a morphic field. Sheldrake posits that there's a field that informs, and that every member of a species has a field, and data is communicated unconsciously between its members. And Sheldrake says, well, that's how homing pigeons know how to find their way back. It's how migrating birds move around. It's how salmon know where to return. And it's how trees communicate. When an illness strikes a group of trees, it communicates to other trees. And Sheldrake saw Hellinger early days working and said, you're the first person I know who works with these morphic fields, and these fields that transmit information between family members and ancestors. And there are also fields in organizations, but that's slightly different. Well, Hellinger said that people behave in certain ways in this family system, and weaker members or younger members in the system become entangled with the older ones when they do something that has an impact beyond the here and now moment in space. And that Hellinger didn't work much at all with what he called the personal soul, the individual soul. He just worked with these family fields. And there were researchers at a university in Switzerland that tracked patterns back 600 years in the ancestry, where events that people got married on the same dates, and there were cycles of people having similar names and deaths occurring on the same time. And That has to do with all energy is memory. All of our experiences are stored in energy, and they're stored in places, and that's what Hellinger works with. And so he created this model of having, there are lots of ways to do the model, but the primary model he started with is, say Annette has something she wants to work on, and I would talk to her and get an idea of where the energy lies in what she has to say, and then we'd select people from the group to serve as representatives. And what that means is that you'll step up and you'll stand where she places you, and you'll start to have awarenesses and experiences of the person rather than having your own experience. You'll be experiencing someone else's life. And then we simply do a process to find out what the issue is, what the problem is, and where the resolve is. Because my reality is that there's another field, and in fact there are myriad realities all around, and most of us don't see any of them. In fact, we're unconsciously in denial that they exist. And the moment that they surface into our awareness, we push them away, with the exception of sometimes, you know, the phone rings and you'll pick it up, or before you pick it up, you know who's on the other end of the phone, or the door is knocked and you know someone is there. But in my reality, there are lots of different dimensions to life, and we have access to these other fields where we can get a lot of help, and the field informs how to make change so our lives can be easier. So you know, it's funny, I used to do demonstrations a lot, and this process will work in a demonstration, but it's not built for a demonstration. It's built for healing and creating change. And sometimes I feel a little bit like a snake oil salesman up here, because the context has to do with our intent. And I always I'm a little shy that someone says, well, I want to explore this problem, but we're really doing a show and tell. But nonetheless, we'll look at a constellation and do all of it or bits of it so that you have a flavor. The beautiful thing about this kind of technology is that, say, if I have a problem and I'm having my issue constellated, if any of you have a problem that is at all similar, the movement that happens in the field here will also start happening in your own field. Another beautiful part of it is when I do this work using representatives, because I can do this work by myself on Skype with somebody across the world and be as effective as having a group of people. But if you're standing in representing, say, Annette's father, and you're standing in representing somebody with a life very different than one you've ever lived, you have experiences that you would never have had in other aspects of your life. And you'll become aware of an experience that you wouldn't be capable of having in another context. And so it really is expansive. And your experience through time, if you do these, to me, there's just a sense of, oh my God, the complexities of life. Firstly, there's no room for judgment or criticism, because we can't even hazard a guess at the complexities of the issues leading up and underlying this problem. And there's certainly no room for criticism about how someone's living their life, because there's so much backstory. And so in that respect, it's beautiful in that we have to have great compassion and love people for our plight. So there's great beauty in it. Now, typically, when we make movements, the experience is that when we move, it's a very palpable. You'll either see movements of energy or you'll feel shifts happening in the room. Now, you're not you don't have to be aware of these shifts, because the work will occur whether you're aware of it or not. But it's nice because it evinces that we're actually doing something that we may not understand, or we may not be able to rationalize. And certainly I do a lot of things that are intellectually indefensible, but the experience is very real. And that has to do with the rationale of the non-ordinary is very different than the rationale of an intellect. Were the need to arise, would the need arise to save your own life, would you kill to save your own life? Yeah, not sure. The point in this is that if someone coalesces that warrior and finds that strength within themselves, they're the safest person in the world to be with. Because they'll never go to a place of to use it and use it when it's not necessary. It's the people who don't have that warrior or warrioress intact that are the dangerous ones. They have no relationship with that force inside of them that they can access. And we need to know our non-negotiables. In other words, there are things in our life that we need to let others know that this is not okay. And we need to have the capacities within ourselves to draw those boundaries and say, no, this is not okay. This is a non-negotiable. But until we find that and center ourselves and connect with that aspect of ourselves, we have no boundaries. We really are not standing for something. And so that's the next piece. Now, what's cool about this, that the shifts, even though the energy work was subtle, they're going to move through your system and affect you and your family. Sometimes quite noticeably so in others, sometimes not. And the way that a constellation unfolds, sometimes the shifts are very subtle and you'll need someone else to tell you, have you noticed how different you are, or how come you're different? Sometimes you will notice. And there's also another pattern of you get to a certain point in your life and you'll have to take a decision that may feel as significant as life and death, but in that moment you'll have the capacity to take the decision, wherein in previously you had hints of it, but you didn't have the capacity to choose and execute a choice. But you will have. So there are myriads of ways these unfold. And sometimes with really messy families where there's a lot of siblings and a lot of dynamic, they go into chaos for a year or two or three, and then everything gets smoothed out. So it's really unpredictable, but there are some patterns. Well, we don't live in a world where it's very safe to grieve, because if we really go into grief, we have to have friends around us to take care of us. We don't have that, so we don't grieve. Yeah. Hellinger made the statement that your parents gave you life, and essentially that's enough. And it is. Now, if we want to invoke the idea of love and helping shape a person, but the parents did their job, getting us to the planet. Psychologically, there are deficits, but that's grist for the mill. I'm going to do some teaching around energy so that you all can experience just how different, when we move around in the room, where you're sitting affects how successful we are and whether we feel stable or not. I'm going to talk a little bit. And then I'm going to work with people. It'll be constellation after constellation after constellation. And during the constellations, I'm going to meta comment and make teaching points, teaching about what's going on in energy, maybe what's going on psychologically. I don't know what I'm going to say, but it's I'm mostly a teacher, and yet I'm a do this change work. Now, Hellinger had this model of working with the ancestors, and I will do that, and yet. There's another model that I like to work with the constituencies of a self, because as people, we have a physical body, we have an intellect and mind and imagination, But those parts of us are no bigger than a barnacle on the tail of a whale. And then who we are in non-ordinary reality consists of fields and artifacts and aspects that are in motion. And those are the parts of us that are most significant. And to get the different aspects of ourselves working well together is what really interests me. And it interests me in the sense of, well, what issues did we come into as being, did we incarnate with that we brought from other lifetimes, quote unquote, that all these events that happen in this lifetime simply are prompts to heal. So that as we as souls move through multiples of generations, we can do the healing that not only helps us in this lifetime, but helps us move toward enlightenment, if that if there is such a thing. So I may work with what I call non-ordinary constellations. In other words, working with parts of us that are more real and imperative than anything that we typically think of. When a person presents an issue, the field informs where to go, what to do. I'm just an instrument. So that's the day. Constellations and teaching. Thank you for your gracious attention in this kind of unscripted evening. Thank you for coming out tonight. I wish you well. Good night.